Praise the Lord, precious saints, and welcome to day 5 of the fasting program of the 7 days of crossover as we cross over into 2021. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but it is very, very hot here in Perth, Western Australia at this particular time of the year. But we are still pressing in by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, today's fasting topic is talking about reviving and restoring, because God wants to restore, God wants to revive. And I know that 2020 has been a difficult year for many of us. In actual fact, the enemy may have been attacking you in the area of your finances, in the area of your health, in the area of your marriages. Whatever that area is, God wants to restore. He wants you to claim back all that the enemy has stolen. In actual fact, the Bible says, according to Proverbs 6 verse 31, it says, if a thief is found, he must return back 7 times that has been stolen. And we know, according to John 10:10, that the enemy comes to kill, steal, and to destroy. So today's message, I want to talk about the story of King David. Now, prior to him being crowned the king, he was a fugitive. He was a fugitive running for his life because King Saul, out of jealousy, knew that the anointing was upon the future king, David, and he managed to muster up 600 misfits of those that were rejected by Israel, and they came and served David. And because they were with David, there was an anointing upon David. So when you're around those that have the anointing, there's also a transference of anointing that came upon them, and they also became mighty men of God in defeating many of the enemies of Israel. Yes, they were even still fighting against the enemies of Israel. But in this particular case, he came into the land where the Philistines were, and he sided with them, or he lived with them, and said, look, you know, I will do exactly what God tells me to do, but I am not your enemy in this particular period of time that King Saul is after me. So the king of the Philistines allowed him to stay within a certain area, and they had to be loyal. So any time that they would call them up for any military service, they would be obliged to also support the king of the Philistines at that particular time. And we see at this point, according to 1 Samuel chapter 29 verses 1 to 2, it says, the Philistines gathered all their forces at Aphek, and Israel camped by the spring of Jezreel, and the Philistine rulers marched, and their units of hundreds and thousands, and David and his men were marching at the rear with the king of the Philistines at that particular time. So all the rulers came. All the rulers came to come up against Israel at that time, because King Saul and his son at that time were coming up against the Philistines because they were still looking for David, mind you. And they knew that the Philistines at that stage has got word to the king of Israel, which was King Saul at that time, that he was being, you know, he was being protected there. So he was coming up against them. And according to the word of God, it says that according to 1 Samuel 29 verses 4 to 5, it says, you know, the rulers came together, they had a meeting, and it said, send them back, that they may return to the place you assigned him. He must not go with us into battle, or he will turn against us during the fighting. How better could he regain his master's favor than by taking the heads of his own men? Isn't this the David that sang about in the dances? Saul was slain, his thousands, and David his 10,000s. So they became threatened because they thought that David was actually going to just go and side with the king of Israel, King Saul, to get favor back with him, not knowing that he was just within God's will at that particular time. So you got to understand that where he was was a distance, and the place he was staying was Ziklag. So Ziklag from this destination was about a three-day journey, which was about 50, you know, maybe 70 kilometers, 60 kilometers or 50 miles for the Americans that are listening. So there was a three-day journey. So 3 days there was kind of tiring upon, you know, the men. So he had 600 men. So now he is told to return back. So he returns back. But on return to Ziklag, he has, encountered the smoldering smoke of buildings being burnt, houses being burnt down, and only to find that the wives of King David and also of his 600 men and their children and their servants had all been taken. They'd all been taken by the Philistines. They had destroyed everything and took all the spoil, but did not kill any of the children or did not kill any of their wives. So when they came upon this, you can imagine the men became quite emotional. And according to the Word of God, it says, now the Amalekites had raided the Negev and Ziklag. They had attacked Ziklag and burnt it and had taken captive the women and all who were in it, both young and old, and they killed none of them but carried them off as they went on their way. And according to the Word of God, it says, so David and his men wept aloud until they had no strength left for them to weep. So in their culture, in the Middle East culture, it is common for men also to be emotional, just like women, when it comes to the point of certain things in life. Now, maybe in the Western world, we're kind of like, you know, try to make it out like we're more macho, we don't cry and all that sort of stuff. But in this particular time, in that particular culture, they had become, because they had taken everything from them. And even the hardest of men will also break under certain circumstances in life. So they had wept until really that they had no more tears left. They had no more strength within them because they were so emotional about what happened. They went to go and help this king of the king of Philistine, one of the kings and the leaders there, and then all of a sudden, only to find out that their arch enemy had come to also take and to destroy all their belongings, take what they owed and destroy whatever was left. So we see that, you know, the men blame David because according to the Word of God in verse 6, this is 1 Samuel 36, said David was greatly distressed because the men were thinking and talking of stoning him. Each one was bitter in spirit because of his sons and daughters that were captured. So if David hadn't made us, they probably said, if David hadn't made us go north with the Philistine enemies, this wouldn't have happened. You can hear them say, David should have insisted that we leave some of our men here to defend our families. It's his fault. And some even said, let's stone him. So in the middle of this, you can imagine, you know, it's pretty human to assign blame to someone else when something happens, especially when it's no fault of your own. But to put blame onto someone that's not actually the fault of the situation, it's just the enemy. You know, the enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. He's not always going to come on your best day. He may even come on your worst day, but that is what the devil does. He comes to kill, steal, and to destroy. But Jesus Christ came to give life and life in abundance. But the Bible tells me, nevertheless, the blame that was put upon him would have hurt. But what did he do? But the Bible says, according to verse 6, but in the last section, it says, but David found strength in the Lord his God. He found strength. In other translations, it says that he strengthened himself or encouraged himself. So when we go throughout the book of Psalms, we see that, you know, the author of Psalms is in some section is David himself. So according to the Psalms, if he was to strengthen himself through praying and seeking the Lord, he may have said things like this. In my distress, I called to you, Lord. I cried to my God for help, according to Psalm 18:6. What about Psalm 40, verses 1 to 3? I waited patiently for the Lord, and he turned to me and heard my my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and the mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth and a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Hallelujah. So he came. He had no more strength. When you have no more strength, maybe you've even lost words to say. Maybe you've even gone to the point that you can't even worship God. You can't even praise Him. Maybe He just got down prostrate before the Lord with no strength, with nothing else. See, that is also a form of worship. When you feel that you're so discouraged, so weary, you feel like you've got no strength, maybe you can't even utter a word, I encourage you, get face down on the floor and lay prostrate and say, God, I can't go on, but Lord, in your strength, I can do all things. Oh, Lord, I don't know a way out of this situation, but Lord, I pray that you would strengthen me. And just lay still and wait upon the Lord until the Holy Spirit visits you. And when the Holy Spirit's presence comes upon you, you will also be strengthened. His grace is sufficient for you. For when you are weak, He is strong, precious saints. You might be weak. You might feel like you've lost all strength to go on. You might feel that 2020 was too difficult. But all of a sudden, in the midst of such chaos, God is saying, when you press into me, the Bible says, according to James 4, 7, it says, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. When we submit, it's yielding. It's yielding to God. Have you yielded yourself to the Holy Spirit? Have you yielded yourself to the Lord today that He may give you strength, that He may turn your situation around and help you and deliver you and set you free? So he cried out to God. Maybe he had no words, but God strengthened him. The power and the presence of God. When we come into the presence of God, there's times of refreshing. There is times of renewal. And what happened? He was strengthened. He was strengthened in the presence of the Lord. And then the word of God then goes on to say, according to 1 Samuel 30 verse 17, says, then David was strengthened. That's right. He was strengthened at that particular time. He was strengthened. He was strengthened at that particular time. And then he called out to the priest, the son of Ahimelech, bring me the ephod. And he brought it to him. And David inquired of the Lord, shall I pursue this raiding party while I overtook them? Will I overtake them, pursue them? He answered, God said, you will certainly overtake them and succeed in the rescue. See, when you get into the presence of the Lord and He gives you that strength and things change, then when you start to ask of the Lord, He will respond to you. He will give you the wisdom. He will give you the strategies. He will give you the way of escape so that you can get through and press in through life, precious saints. God is here to deliver all those that call upon His name, but He's calling upon us today. Do we want His help? Do we want to see what God is going to do? And then what happened? He then went on the pursuit. He gathered all the men and he went after the enemies of them that came and took all their children and all their belongings. So they went after them and they found an Egyptian servant that had been tending the fields, and they gave him some food who was sick. And he said to him, who are you? And he says, I am a servant to my master, and my master is of the people that raided your city. And they gave him some food to give him some strength, gave him some water. And he says, will you take me to your master? And he says, I will take you, but unless you make this promise, you will not kill me, nor will you surrender me to my master. So they did. They took him and he took them to the enemy. They saw them and there were so many of them, and they were partying. They were celebrating in their spoils and celebrating in their victory against all those that had left their lands to go and fight a battle so that they could take of their children, take of their families. So when they went in, the Bible says from twilight all the way to the next day, they fought the enemy until there was not one left, only those that had left with camels and deserted them. But they left everything, all the spoil, everything that they'd taken. And the Bible says Then David attacked them, and it says that the Bible says that it says that they fled, and then so David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away, and David rescued his two wives, and nothing of theirs was lacking, neither small or great, sons and daughters, spoil or anything which had been taken from them. David recovered all. Somebody say recovered all. This is your year to recover all that the enemy has been coming against you. Whatever he has stolen from you, whatever he has taken you, it might be missed opportunities. It might be missed circumstances. God is saying he can restore all, but you've got to pursue the enemy, because the enemy will come in and try to come and steal you when you're off guard. He will try to put blame into you. He will try to whisper condemnation to you, but you've got to rise up and say, devil, you live under my feet. You know, this past night I had this dream, and I was prophesying over people in this dream. And then all of a sudden, someone came up behind me and said, I will kill you one day. And it was such a dark voice. And I knew it was just utter evil. So I turned around and I grabbed this person and I put it onto the ground. And I could see that the person was a handsome face, but as I rebuked it, it started to transform into the face of the devil himself. And he said to me, I will kill you one day. And I rebuked him there. I said, I shall not die, but live and declare the good works of the Lord. And I started to rebuke the devil. And what occurred to me then? He couldn't kill me then. He couldn't kill me. He couldn't touch me. Just like Job, he couldn't be killed by the devil. He tried to attack other areas, maybe his children, maybe his wife, maybe his belongings, maybe his possessions, but he could not kill him. And I started to rebuke the devil. And I knew straight away then that the work of the Lord that I'm doing is such an effect that it's stirring up the devil so much that he himself had to come to me. It just reminds me of those type of movies where there's always a villain and he usually sends his other people to do the dirty work, until it gets to the point that every time that they send the villains out to attack them, you know, the soldiers underneath them, they always get killed, until the point that the enemy is so annoyed that he himself has to come and threaten the person that is defeating all the people under him. Let me know. We are a threat to the devil, precious saints. We are a threat. And it's just stirred me up even more to say, devil, I'm going to fight back 7 times more. I'm going to come back 100 times more to make sure that souls are snatched out that are on their way to hell. We're going to go even stronger against the enemy's plans to try to come against what God is doing in this hour. I don't know what's going on in your life now, but all I know is that God has a plan for you, and he wants to restore all the things that the devil has stolen from you. And if you're a threat to the devil, let me tell you, your name may not be popular with other people around, but when your name is popular in hell because you are a threat to him, let me tell you, that's all that matters. That's all that matters, that we are doing the kingdom work, that we are a threat to the devil. And whatever he's doing, we're going to come back 10 times worse. We're going to come back and work for God even more harder, even more fervently, until the Lord calls us home. The Bible says, fear no one. Fear no one, but fear God. He has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, love, and of a sound mind. He wants you to press into this year. He wants you to gain and restore all that has been stolen from you. Maybe in 2020, maybe in previous years, whatever the enemy has been stealing from you. Maybe it's your health, he's been stealing your health. Maybe it's your children, and your prodigal children are going to come back as you claim back all. Maybe it's your marriage. God can restore all things. God can restore all things if we put our trust in him. What God puts together, no man shall tear apart. Can somebody say amen? As we are crossing over into this new year, God has a plan for your life. God has a plan for my life. And he wants us to draw closer to him like never before. Can I get an amen? Amen. He has a plan for your life. Ask the Lord for that refreshing wind of the Holy Spirit to blow upon you. Yes, decree that you are being given new strength. Maybe emotionally, spiritually, physically, today, whatever that situation is, just lay prostrate before the Lord and say, God, I'm going to serve you no matter what. No matter what the devil's plaguing against me, no matter what he's scheming against me, every scheme is being exposed in the name of Jesus Christ. Let us pray, precious saints. Heavenly Father, I pray for each person today that you will strengthen them. Lord, I thank you that your word says, according to Proverbs 6:31, when a thief is bound, he must return back seven times it has been stolen. And according to John 10:10, the devil who comes to kill, steal, and destroy, he is a thief. We expose the thief today that you will return back seven times that has been stolen for each person as they cross over into this year. I decree and declare that the good doors that were closed against them, maybe in 2020 or even in past years, they will be open wide for each person to enter in and possess their possessions, their things within 2021 in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that no plans of the enemy against them shall materialize in 2021 in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Every plan, every agenda of the enemy is exposed today in Jesus' name. The promises of God concerning each person's life, both past and present, must all be fulfilled within 2021 in the name of Jesus Christ. Whoever planned or is planning any evil against each person, that plan shall fall in this year of 2021 in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I decree and declare that the purpose, plans, proclamations, perceptions, permissions, and all strategies of Satan, demons, and their human agents will never be birthed within each person's life, within each person's family life, within their marriage, within their job, within their business, within their education, within their ministry, and it shall not come to pass in 2021 in the name of Jesus Christ. We expose it today. We decree that every broken wall, that every stolen or lost moment will be restored unto them today and within this year of 2021 in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray right now, Lord, that each person will walk in their dominion of authority in Christ Jesus and bring the whole of the remaining year before God today. Lord, as we prophesy into their season, that they will prosper. Lord, that no matter what goes on, no matter the shaking that is happening right now within the church, within the nations, it will not affect any person in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, but you will touch each person today in Jesus' mighty name. Lord, wherever there is anything hidden, any hidden strongholds that are blocking each person's progress within life, Lord, I pray against those strongholds and any strongholds that you're aware of, I want you to just bring and mention them right now in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, whatever those strongholds are. Lord, I ask God to reveal those strongholds within your life that they can be broken today in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I command them to be broken today in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that the Lord would open up doors for revival. Yes, Lord, open up the doors for revival, that you would revive your church once more as we seek your face today, as we come closer to you. Lord, I know that the people will press in as we are pressing in on day 5 of this fasting. Lord, give them the grace, give us all the grace to keep pushing on, to keep serving God, despite of how we feel, but despite of our circumstances, our situation, we're going to press forward. We're going to do everything that the enemy is doing in the opposite direction. If he comes against us, we're going to come against him even harder in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Come and touch your people. Come and fill them today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This is Pastor Robert Clancy from Narrow Path Ministries in Perth, Western Australia. It is time to catch the fire of repentance revival as we prepare for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Shalom, shalom, shalom. And if you like this utterance today, we encourage you to subscribe to the YouTube channel, follow us on Facebook or Instagram, go to our free website, repentancerevival.com. And I encourage you, if you have, or if the first time you're hearing this, you can join this 7-day fast and you can start from tomorrow. the program's there to do it your own pace, in your own time, and you can use these daily uploads to encourage you, to strengthen you to get through. So from my family to yours, God bless you. We love you. We are praying for you, precious saints. Shalom, shalom, shalom.